هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله لا نحصي ثناء عليه، هو كما أثنى على نفسه. الحمد لله كما ينبغي لجلال وجهه وعظيم سلطانه. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد رسول الله عليه وآله أفضل الصلاة والسلام. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يعص الله فلا هادي له. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in the Quran and in our way of thinking and devoting our lives to Allah, there are issues in which we live. As we try to satisfy Allah subhanahu throughout these years that have been allocated to us in our lifespan, the issues that we are concerned with are issues within a social, an economic, and a political context. Islam is like a fish that swims within this context that is filled with these types of issues. When we think about it, we find that there are also other people who may not agree with the methodology of Islam and with the workable program of Islam, but nevertheless, they may share the same objectives within this pool of political, economic, and social ideas. It has been the practice of many Muslims to isolate themselves from these same people who share the same objectives, but nevertheless with differing and maybe at times programs that are set apart. But this should never serve as an excuse for a Muslim not finding common grounds with those who do have the same objectives and goals, at least in as far as communications are concerned. We all know that Allah's emissaries and envoys, may His peace and blessings be upon Him, they were not great because of ideas and of speeches that they delivered to their people. They were great because they championed the germane and the related issues of their times and their ages. They championed those issues in a practical sense. The economic, the social, and the political context that serves as a pool within which a Muslim's concerns swim. This pool also is shared with its interests, with its setbacks, with its problems. promises. It is also shared by other human beings who recognize the same problems, but they do not recognize the same working program that Allah offered. But this doesn't justify a boycott between the Muslims and these other peoples who are also at the receiving end of isolation, of repression, of oppression. Brothers and sisters in Islam, when we come and take a look at the meanings and the message of the Quran and the explanation of this message by Allah's beloved messenger alayhi wa alihi salatu wa salam, we find that this messenger said, in trying to address one of the issues within the context in which a Muslim lives, and this is only as an example, and it is in no way exhausting, of this concern of the Prophet, a concern that is shared by people who are not within the abode or within the working program of Islam. من كان معه فضل ظهر فليعد به على من لا ظهر له ومن كان له فضل زاد فليعد به على من لا زاد له. He who has more than what he needs of a means of transportation should offer it to whom is lacking in that need. And he who has more than what he needs of food or water or sustenance should provide it to him who is lacking in food and water and sustenance. Now this type of hadith is addressed to a human condition of people who are lacking. It is not permissible for a Muslim to monopolize or to hoard or even to possess anything in addition to what he needs, as long as there are those other people, those other Muslims, those other human beings who are in need of that addition. It is even justified for a Muslim to wage war, or for a group of Muslims to wage war against those who have possessed that addition of money, of sustenance, of land, of transportation means, or the other necessities that are guaranteed for human beings and for Muslims. The right of shelter that is guaranteed in Islam, the right of the satisfaction of the urge of hunger and thirst, and the right to work, and the sanctity of shelter, all of these rights are guaranteed within the provisions in which Allah subhanahu created man. These rights, as are detailed by the Prophet and by the Quran, are rights that serve as the objectives of people who do not have Islam as their working program, for many reasons. But this this doesn't mean that Muslims should isolate themselves from these issues because certain non-Muslims have taken these issues as their objectives and as their theories for a working program. Muslims should try to be in contact with these different people who have these issues as their issues, and there will be a great amount of good as a result of this contact. How many are those individuals and those persons who are deceived because of the absence of Islam? Of these people who are championing these causes of justice and truth, are doing so because Islam is not given to them and Islam is not presented to them. And how can Islam be presented if a Muslim does not carry on his shoulder the affairs and the agonies of the people to live with them among the people? Islam will continue to be isolated and continue to occupy an area in an ivory tower if we, the Muslims ourselves, do not step down into the realm of reality, a reality that is made up of these economic, these social, and these political issues, and then work with the people so that the people may identify us not by what we say, but by the issues that we carry and how we behave towards the accommodation of those same objectives. The Quran speaks to us the consequences of such people who were detached, that this detachment even affected their doctrinal belief, and as a consequence of that, their destiny was to what the Quran refers to as saqar, as an abode of torture and suffering. مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ وَلَمْ نَكُ نُطْعِمُ الْمِسْكِينَ. Why is your result? Why have you found yourselves in saqar? In the torture chamber that Allah has prepared for those who have disobeyed Him. Their reply was, we were not of those who had a prayer relationship with the other people, with the other Muslims. The cohesion and the solidarity that is brought about by the objectives of praying together, of being together, and then the subsequent result of وَلَمْ نَكُ نُطْعِمُ الْمِسْكِينَ. Of course, if a person is present in prayers and then he is detached from those around him, then he is also detached from the other circle that is farther away from the circle of prayer, and those who are in need, those who are in poverty, those who are lacking in means and ways in this life, those were not within the vision of this person. So he found himself in the suffering chamber that Allah has prepared for him. This detachment has even been made a means of waging war, the justification of war against those who are so much detached from the plight and understand the issues of the Muslims that Allah subhanahu has justified waging war against them to gain the rights that Allah has decreed for us. In one of the explanations of the ayah, فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُ الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. One of the extended explanations of this ayah is those people who have monopolized the providence, the wealth, the provisions that Allah has given. And then as a result of that, other peoples are suffering. Allah said that this category of people is called al-baghiya, one who has aggressed against the rights of others. So it becomes the right of others to launch a war against this class of people. These issues that are related to us in the Quran should be issues that draw us towards the same people who recognize the same issues. The problem with those who are in charge and entrusted with Islam is that they begin to see the differences before they see the commonality between them and the other peoples around them. Whom from among us can deny that those who are opposed to this system are receiving the same hardships, or probably relatively less, than the Muslims are receiving? They incur those hardships not because they are propagating about them, but because they have a program, a workable program. And then the same source of oppression that targets the Muslims targets these people. Why can't the Muslims find a common ground between them and the other people who have the same objectives? At least something that is workable, and not have Islam isolated away from these issues to be used by the forces and by the system of the status quo. Brothers and sisters in Islam, one of the pillars of Islam, az-zakah, which is a divine interference into the particulars of your heart, the inclinations of your soul. Who is not attached to money? But Allah, in prescribing for the Muslims the act of paying out of their money and their wealth, is drawing them away from the allurement of the shaitan and putting them in the condition of al-masakeen and al-fuqara and the other six categories to which this money and this right is due. And then if this is not enough, then these people who are in need, they have the right to money outside of the allocated zakah. And the Prophet says, "Fi malika haqqun siwa zakah." These issues draw the Muslim, draw the individual from a personalized Islam and puts him in the condition of those who are poverty-stricken, those who are oppressed, and those who are in need. If we do not live that condition, we are living in the absence of the objectives of Islam, and it might be that those people who are struggling for these objectives, in the absence of the presentation of Islam to them, that in the sight of Allah, they may be better than those who do have Islam, but are doing nothing for it or nothing about it. أدعو الله سبحانه وتعالى وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة فقلت استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا ويمددكم بأموال وبنين ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم أنهارا. الحمد لله بجميع المحامد على جميع النعم، وصلى الله وسلم على المبعوث رحمة وهدى وخيرا لكافة الأمم النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Brothers and sisters, the political air that has been charged with discussions among those who self-style themselves as superpowers. These political discussions are an accumulation of years and of facts. They are not at the leisure of any of these master kafirs, whether he is here in Washington or there in Moscow. These meetings are a recognition of the fact that these powers, because they claimed a popularity due to the issues in the case of this system here and this establishment, due to the issue of liberty and freedom, which is a false issue, because today there is no liberty and there is no freedom. Where is the liberty and the freedom if this is our situation today? Praying in the street and being banned from the house of Allah. This system has worked itself up to becoming synonymous and similar to the atheist system in the Soviet Union. And then on the other hand, as regards that other superpower, it built its popularity upon the just distribution of wealth, a claim of socialism. And that also is a misnomer, because there is no just distribution of wealth there. There are those people who are suffering. There are those people who are very rich, and there are those people who are poor inside of that system. What is the difference between the lifestyle of Gorbachev and the lifestyle of Reagan? Both of them feed off the miseries of the people. And because these theories of liberty and freedom, and then the theories of the just distribution of wealth and socialism, have proved a failure to the peoples of the world, as these theories are produced for the peoples of the world, this meeting between these two heads of state, and because they are described as a success, should mean one thing to us Muslims, and that is that they have succeeded in proving their failure, and they have succeeded in coordinating themselves and their policies to such a degree that they can sit down and and begin to proclaim to the world audience that they have many things in common everywhere between the cultural and the political. There are many issues in common. And from the understanding of this world, from the lens of the Quran, what they have in common is to solidify the status quo of oppressing the Muslims and the deprived segment of humanity. This is their common grounds. This is how they gain power. This is how they approach the audience of this world. Brothers and sisters in Islam, being that they have proved their failure, the arena is open for the Muslims. But the Muslims will not be successful if they do not make out of the issues of life Islamic issues. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Today, how many of us hear about different issues? The issue of AIDS, acquired immunity deficiency syndrome. How many of us hear about this issue? Everyone, Muslim and non-Muslim alike, hears about this issue. But how many of us have incorporated this issue into our Islam? How many of us have been propelled by our Islam to address the audience that is watching this disease with the solution that Islam offers for a clean environment, for a clean social order, for a clean sexual behavior, for a clean mind and motivation and desire within man that rids him of this awful plague that is beginning to take on the interest of whomever is tuned in to the issues of the date. The issue of racial discrimination, the issue of racism, is an issue ingrained into Western life. And because of the failure of these two systems in solving these issues, we Muslims cannot offer our solution if we do not make this issue an issue that is related to Islam. How many of us are propelled by our Islam to address this issue and to bring those people who are incarcerated by either white or black into the light of Islam, in which this does not exist? Brothers and sisters, those even in this area who do not have a shelter, do not have a place to stay, to spend their night, these homeless people are championed by people who do not have the light or the concept of Islam. And we do. How many of us have been propelled by our Islam to go and be with these people, to understand their condition, first of all, and then to offer them the abundance and the solution of Islam? Brothers and sisters in Islam, the audience in this world is alert today to the failures of man-made ideologies and systems. They are looking for a way out of this trap between the communists and the capitalists. And we are the ones that can offer... and the capitalists, and we are the ones that can offer this audience a solution, but we can't do so if we do not belong to the miseries and to the oppression and the injustices of this audience. It is our duty to belong to them, to feel with them, and to think with them. And we thank Allah that our praying here is a contribution to that audience, that we are not insulated, at least during this hour of the week, from that larger audience that we belong to. And Islam has irritated these wicked sources of power that today, even in this capital, in Washington, D.C., because some Muslims have begun to stick a slogan or a statement on their taxis that they are beginning to consider a prohibition by law from sticking these types of statements, such as "I love Allah," or "There is no God except Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and God is great," and the rest of these statements. How many are the Christian statements, "Praise the Lord," or "Christians are not perfect, but only forgiven," and the rest of these statements, and no one was thinking about banning them. But when Muslims began to display their ideas in these limited statements, the law is beginning to contemplate a procedure and a process against them. It is because they are bankrupt, and Islam is the solution, and we offer the solution from within and not from without. Allahumma arina al-haqq haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah, wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabah, wa la taj'alhu multabisan alayna, واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا لا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا. ربنا لا تجعلنا فتنة للذين كفروا. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق، وأنت خير الفاتحين. وصل اللهم على محمد وآل محمد. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها، وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل، وأقيموا الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.